to be here. This is like coming home for me. And I walked into David's parents' house last night, yesterday evening. I really just felt like I was surrounded by love. And I always feel that way when I come here. Last time I came, my husband was not with me. At that time, he was suffering from an illness that eventually he had not been able to conquer. It's difficult being without him because we were spiritual partners in life, and he was the love of my life. So I would not be what I'm doing if it wasn't for my husband. He was my cheerleader. He was my spiritual covering. He was my teacher. I learned so much from him. And those of you that are married or are going to be married or have been married can understand that when the Lord puts someone in your life, that it's for a reason. It's not just for us to not be alone, but there's a purpose that God has. In 2001, my mother went home to be with the Lord on September 7th. On September 11th, 2001, which is a date you all know, was her funeral. That day I felt like my life was over. I thought the end of the world was here, and there was no reason for me to go on. I tell you this because I want to encourage you. When you feel like the darkest day has come, or you feel like there's no hope or no reason to go on, I am a living testimony that God can restore. It's funny to say that, having just recently lost my husband, but the grace of God has kept me. I have never felt more close to the Lord in my life. Saying that, death of a spouse is probably the hardest thing that anyone could ever go through. I feel like my spirit was ripped in half. Like part of me was gone. And how do you recover from that? Only God.
Amen. Yeah.
Only God's faithfulness to be with me every moment of every day has brought me to where I am now. So in 2003, we founded Visions of Praise Ministries, and my husband and I were called to minister to pastors, to encourage small churches. My husband liked to call them the cornfield churches out in the country, that the pastor would get discouraged and feel like, you know, things just weren't going the way he thought, and that he had no one to talk to or share with. Because how many know pastors are people? You know, they go through emotions, they go through depression, they go through anxiety, they go through stress. They have a calling on their life to shepherd people, to be the person that is there to listen to everyone's needs, and to have a heart to care for them and teach them what they need to know to get through life. My husband was that person. He was not called to pastor a church, he was called to evangelize, but he had the heart of a pastor. And I honor him today, again, because he encouraged me in the ministry that we came into after doing outreach ministry for many years, preaching on the streets, feeding the homeless, clothing them, taking in people off the street. God gave me a heart for women. I've always felt like being raised up under Dr. Sumrall, learning demonology and deliverance at a very young age, that I wanted to see women set free. I didn't want to see them in bondage. So that led to the daughters of Naomi embraced. I love the book of Ruth. It's one of my favorite. And I have to say my husband was like a father to the women that would come to us. And they loved him and gave him a name, a nickname of Papa Al. And it was a beautiful thing because these women most times did not have a father in their life. They did not know what it was like to be loved by a man other than someone that wanted to take advantage of them. And so our mission was to empower women to be able to overcome addictions, abuse, abandonment, and to be able to be not only spiritually strong, but also independent financially. One thing I find is that when women are unable to support themselves, they look to a man to take care of them. And that's not wrong in the right context. If you're married, your husband should be the leader of the household, the provider. That's what God placed in men. They want to do that. But for those that are just looking to take, they're not looking to give, these women experience some traumatic things. I have some pictures out in the foyer that are on the laptop sitting there. You can look at them later, but a lot of the faces you'll see are women who are not what they look like. Once they were strung out on heroin or other substances, they were giving their bodies to be used just to be able to get by, and some of them died and came back. You've heard a few testimonies of some ladies that we brought with them that had suffered various things, but what I want to talk to you about today is that the hope of God is something that we need to share as the body of Christ. The hope of his calling, the hope of what Jesus did for us, that he died for every one of our sins that we would ever commit, whether it be something in the past or something in the future. The Bible says that there is none that are righteous. The Bible says that all have fallen short of the glory of God. None of us of our own merit would make it. It is only because of the blood of Jesus. So this fall, September 28th, we're holding our third annual banquet for the Daughters of Naomi Embraced. I believe that when the Lord put this in my heart to be able to have a place for women to come where they feel safe, is that when it says in Ruth that I will go where you go, I will live where you live, your God will be my God, your people will be my people, that the women that come will be like daughters, they'll be like family, but also they'll want to know the God that I know.
Amen.
They'll want to know about him, but they'll want to have that relationship with him that's going to get them through the rest of their life. So, just to give you an idea, my husband, being like a father to these women, they were able to see something in their life that they had never seen before. A man who wanted nothing from them. A man who was there to pray for them, to encourage them, to give them scripture, to teach them, and to say, I believe in you, you're beautiful, you can make it, God loves you, and you're worth it. Something much more than you've ever known. So our theme this year for the banquet, and I have some flyers out there. I want to thank Pastor Dave and Sharon, my spiritual parents, my dear brother and sister in Christ, for allowing me to come back and to share with you, but also for supporting the ministry. Some of you are very faithful to give, and I appreciate that. The women appreciate it. They would not be able to do a lot of the things they're doing right now, which I want to give you just a couple brief testimonies of where they've come from and where God's taken them. But if it had not been for your prayers, your support, your love, we just appreciate you so much. And as your church, Living Water Lighthouse is sponsoring a table this year at the banquet, we just want you to know how much this will do for the women that come into the ministry. We have a mentoring and support group weekly, so they are taught, and they also have someone come alongside of them. They're taught the Word of God, but they're also trained in how to fill out a resume, how to fill out an application. We do mock interviews. We get these women to a place where they can stand on their own two feet, they can get a good job. And the thing is that some of these women come out of prison. So some are on house arrest, some are unable to go into a place of employment and fill out an application and even get an interview. They look at their record and they throw it away. So what we've done is we've been able to get our women in positions of authority in businesses. Right now, one of our women who came to us that was an addict and giving her body to survive, had a 5-year-old autistic son. She was at a breaking point. She wasn't able to get up and go to work. She felt like she was powerless, had no ability to make any decisions in her life that would be of value. And basically, I spoke life into her, loved on her, went over to her house, drug her into work, and said, "You're going to do this."
Wow, praise God.
And this is what God's placed inside of me. This is a calling. It's not something everybody can do. But I saw that girl go from feeling worthless to knowing who she was in Christ, leaving this relationship and putting down the drugs and being a mother to her son, and now she's a sales director at a hotel.
Cool.
Yeah. She in turn has been able to help one of our ladies who's come to us recently that has a record, unable to get a job. On Sunday, I introduced them. On Monday, she had an interview and was hired immediately. This is what the power of God is doing in our community. And, you know, a lot of times when you can't see it or there's a distance, you think, you know, what can I do? How can I help? You know, this isn't relevant to me. But we are one body. What affects one of us affects us all. And when we can make a difference in the community, whether it be right here or whether it be a few hours away, that is accounted to your account in heaven. God is going to reward you for praying for us, for supporting us, or whatever it is that you can do. And I want you to know what it means to God when you give. So, to make a long story short, I just want to say that these women that come in, that like the heroin addict that she tried for years to get clean, was in and out of programs, and was unable to stop with help or without help on her own. The Lord had put it in my heart to go to the house she was staying at with her parents and tell her that if she did not get medical attention that night, she would die. This was a very hard thing for me to do. How do you tell someone that? You tell them that because you love them and because you don't want to see that happen. So that next morning, her mother took her to the emergency room. She was so strung out, but trying to detox on her own because there was no help in our community. They have shut down all of the places that they could go to get the medication to help them detoxify. Well, we're fighting for these women's lives. So after she was able to get help medically, then I told her, I said, had you not gone and done that, I couldn't help you anymore. This is a very hard thing to say to people, but we have to say the hard things.
Amen.
We have to be the one to stand up Devil, no more. Because these are precious lives to our God, to our Lord, to our Father. So this fall, we're holding the third annual banquet. The theme of it is a father's heart. We believe that God is going to take this ministry to the next level. And I want to honor my husband in that because
Amen.
Of how instrumental he was in seeing me through to do what God's called me to do, being the head of it, being the president of our organization. And, you know, I'm so thankful, so grateful. Because I see these lives that come to us that are in such despair. And I can relate, I can understand. I was not raised with a father, so I understand what it's like to look for that and not find it. But I found it in God. I found my heavenly Father that loves me more than any earthly father ever could. And I thank God for the spiritual fathers that he's placed in my life. So I just want you to know, when these things happen, when God sends these women to us, and when we see their lives changed, that we thank God for those that are praying. We thank God for those that are standing by us, and that I can continue to do what God's called me to do, regardless of my circumstances. Because I stand before you today saying this has not been easy. This has been very, very difficult. But I know what God has placed in me, and I know I can't give it up. There are too many lives at stake.
Amen.
So there's scripture in Ezekiel 17 that talks about the eagle. The story refers to the Babylonian king and the Egyptian king, and how they were trying to take Israel. But you know, God did something there. He did something miraculous. And it was a parable, but he was talking about what he was going to do. And I believe in Ezekiel 17, 3 through 8, that's our story right now. That these branches that are coming out, that have been picked out by God, are bursting forth and springing forth new life. And I believe that what he's going to do in that is phenomenal. It's limitless. These women can literally change the way that our world is going. And I want you to know that when I say that and it sounds, wow, that's ridiculous. But think about it. Think about how you affect someone's life every day. The things you say, the things you do, people are watching you. You know, they want to see. I had a lady come up to me in church during worship and say, every time you raise your hands, you're telling people, no matter what you've been through, you still worship God. Yes. And they can see that. So I thank the Lord for that. I just want to close with a scripture from Ephesians. Chapter 4, verse 13 through 16. It says, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. This is what we desire most, is for all of us to come to the fullness of Christ. That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men, and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive, but speaking the truth in love,
Amen.
May grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. Again, I want to thank you all for your love, for your support, for your prayers. I look forward to every time that I can come and spend time with my dear friends, and be with you all and share what God is doing. There's so many things I could tell you. I'm looking at writing a newsletter to send up and give you some stories of some of the women and how God's changing their lives, so that will be coming. And a report of how the banquet goes. Believing God's going to do some great things. What we want to see happen in the next year or so is the house be turned into a place where women can live. We have taken in one at a time. I'd like to be able to take in more. So we're looking at putting in a full bath in the basement. So that's our next move, is to be able to put a flush toilet and a shower and all those good things that women need, because one bathroom is just not going to be enough. So we just believe God to take us to the next level. So I appreciate your prayers on that, and that you would just remember these women. It's difficult, but we stick with them and we see God transform their lives. Amen.
Stay up there.
If anybody's got a question, I'd love for you just to ask any question you'd like. I'd love to try to answer.
When is the birthday?
It's September 28th. It's a Saturday evening. And so anyone that wants to come, let me know, and we will have a seat for you. And it is a catered meal. It's going to be at Christian Center Church in South Bend. So it's a few hours from here, but we'd love for you to come.
What are the age groups of these women?
So they range. They can be adult women, so anywhere from their 20s to their 40s. We have had older 50s, so it's kind of funny to be a mother to, women older than me, but not much older.
And some of them have just got out of jail or out of prison.
Right.
Some have been over here at Rockville.
Yep.
You know, they feel that nobody cares and nobody wants them, and there ain't no God, basically, to their point. And then this ministry rises up and they hear something that the Holy Spirit will take and do a work.
Yes.
And then you guys work with the Holy Spirit and just meet that love.
Yeah.
Another question.
Just to let you know, too, they do give testimonies, so we do visit churches and we do have them share what God's done in their lives, which
we've had them here.
Yeah, they've been here a couple times. Yeah.
But the ones that was here, they were down and out and really hurting whenever they came, and now they're giving testimonies and got jobs and, you know.
And they're teaching other women. We do have some brochures out there that explains the different organizations we go into. Been into the homeless shelter, but we also go into an at-risk educational facility for kids that couldn't make it in a regular public school, and we've been able to teach them coping skills, anger management, all kinds of wonderful things that they couldn't get otherwise, especially like one of our ladies who did come out of Rockville and did learn. She was actually teaching in the prison when she was there. So.
So how much help do you actually have?
We have several mentors that help with the ladies. So when they come to our group,
Pastor Jack.
Yeah, we also have a pastor that is teaching our weekly meetings, Pastor Jack Smith. And he's been phenomenal to step in when a time when I really needed help. We've had a lady even host the meetings at her home while I was going through the grieving. We have moved it back to the house, so they are having weekly meetings there. Anyone else?
So how many, you said moving them back into the house, how many do
the
you
meetings.
Hope to have?
Oh,
the
yeah, meetings. Yeah. So we've continued to help women when
Excuse
they are in need.
I think we're probably on the video out there that you'll be seeing that Al went and converted his garage and made it in a way that they could bring the ladies in there and have classes in the garage, and redid the basement and working on the basement to make a facility that, some of them are, they need a place to get off of the street now, so that's one of their ambitions, is to get a place where they can help these girls that are strung out,
mm-hmm.
maybe with child, whatever.
Yes.
It's a big ministry, folks. It's
that's kind of what I wondered, because it's just kind of like,